Good evening, everyone. Today we are talking about the testing strategies for the Agile teams. Before I start with it, I would like to introduce myself. Hi, I'm Sakshi Mahajan. I have 12 plus years of experience in the IT industry. I'm PMI ACP certified. I'm currently working as an Agile technical coach with an organization in Virginia, US, Capital One, where I'm helping teams with their with adopting technical practices. I wore many hats in my career. In fact, I worked as a developer in an Agile team. I've also worked as a Scrum Master, Product Owner, a PM, and now I'm working as a coach, helping others embrace Agile. Like I talked about, I have multiple, I've experienced in multiple things, Scrum, Kanban, as well as XP practices. This is the agenda for today. Talking about the XP practices, we won't be actually covering TDD, ATDD, and exploratory testing a lot in detail, but I'll be just briefing you about it. And if needed, we can have another session where we can talk in detail about these practices. Now, what's the common challenge in Agile? The common challenge that I see in Agile is that people embrace Scrum, which is really good for managing work, but it is just a way to manage and plan your work. And when the teams are churning out code so fast, how do you guarantee quality? Every sprint end of every 2 weeks, it's, you know, humanly impossible to actually go back and test whatever you've built, you know, the product that's there in the past few weeks, months, or even years. You can't manually test it. And that's where, when you just adopt Scrum and not any other practice, it becomes a little challenging. Okay, so here we have a poll. I would like to understand from each one of you, which of these does your current team practice? Do you practice only Scrum, Scrum plus XP, Kanban, Kanban plus XP? Just choose one of these. Okay, so it looks like 40% of the people only follow Scrum, and that's a challenge. That's where you're churning out code and you do not know about the quality of the code. 3% people say Kanban, and around 30% people say Scrum plus XP, which is great. I have another poll for you. So these polls will help me understand the audience, where exactly we stand. So the poll says, how do you rate yourself as an individual on XP? You're not aware, aware but not practiced, a novice, aware, tried and rejected, you didn't like it, intermediate level in XP practices, and expert in XP practices. Choose one of these. Okay. So I see that around 40% people are aware of it, but have not practiced it. That's nice, at least you have the information. And around 20% people feel they're intermediate level in XP practices. And there's 2% who sees themselves as an expert. That's great. One more. So what is the current state of dev and QA in your team? That's really important. Are developers in QA part of different teams? Are they part of the same team? They are full stack engineers and test and develop XP style. Choose one of these. So here are the results. 55% say they are part of the same team, and they just 3%, which are full-stack engineers and test and develop XP style. The rest say developers and QA are part of different teams. So it's nice that 55% people are part of the same team, because that's the start of it. That's the team mindset. Before we deep dive, it's very important for us to know it's not the strongest of the species that survive, not the most intelligent, but the only most responsive to change. That's said by Charles Darwin years back. That's what Agile says, embrace the change. Now, the most important thing to go for when we are moving towards this journey is to understand we are a team. We are not developer versus QA. we are one team. So I'm glad 55% of you said that you're, you know, part of one team, because the idea is to work together. We are not individuals working for the goal. We are a team working towards the goal. So it's not about finding bugs, but about collaborating and producing something which does not have product. And everybody tests. It's not a QS job to test. It's not a developer's job to just write code. Developer, when he's writing some code, he's developing something, he needs to be sure that he's building, you know, creating it right. So the mindset of we are one team is really, really important. On a lighter note, I don't always test my code, but when I do it in production. I hope a lot of you have not done this. Testing is part of definition of done. So whenever you pick up a story, whenever you start working on a story, you need to know that it's only done when you've tested it. You can mark it as definition of done. You can add it to your definition of done. That will help you, you know, to keep in mind. But apart from that also, it's also, you know, it should be a mindset that you need to have. Start automating. Start building a regression suite. So whenever you write tests along with your code, in a way, you're also building a regression suite, which is taking care of that you're not breaking something you built in the past. So it's really easy to actually, you know, build up something for this sprint and maybe test whatever 2 weeks work is done. But what about the work that you've done in the past? What about the product that you've built in the past? It's humanly impossible to manually test each and everything at the end of each sprint about what you've done. So the key is test all the time. And if you keep doing it manually, it won't work. What you have to do is have some regression suite, an automated regression suite, which is running in parallel. Whenever you check in, it executes. We'll see what are the practices that can help you. Another Dilbert fun element, how long will it take to fix the bugs in our control management layer? Do you want a realistic estimate that will ruin your day, or a lie that will allow your ignorance and your happiness to lock arms and square dance to the next cubicle? That second option sounds festive. I'm a pleaser. So we all know what happens when bugs go into the backlog. They just get piled up, and we don't know when we're going to fix them. So we need to avoid that the bugs are introduced, and instead of putting bugs at the end, one thing, when working on a story, fix it then and there, instead of, you know, actually putting it in the backlog and working on it later. So it should be like, let's find bugs. It should be part of when you're working, when you're writing tests and your code, you're actually just trying to see what's working and what's not. Even if the bugs go into the backlog, we need to prioritize them in the sprint planning instead of just piling them up. Do not accumulate bugs. The more bugs you accumulate, the more you'll make your life difficult when you're working on building up new functionality. It happens a lot of times, you know, when we start building a new functionality, we discover bugs and we're like, we are in a dilemma. Should we fix it right now or later? The best thing would be if we can fix them then and there. But there are some bugs that we find out which are low priority, which goes to the backlog, which has to go to the backlog. So that's where we need to prioritize them in the sprint planning. Okay, now let's see what can be done. I know you guys are asking questions, and as the organizer is not available, so I'm getting all those questions right now. I think we'll take it at the end, all those questions. I was planning to take half of them, you know, in between, but as we've lost some time in, you know, starting it up also, I'll prefer taking them up at the end. Okay, talking about the testing triangle. Previously, what was happening was we had some manual tests, which was, you know, manual testing was covering up the most of the part. Then there were some automated tests that were written, but which were, again, just covering the functional aspect. And then the developers wrote some integration tests and unit tests. Like, some had that feeling, oh, developers used to feel, testing is not my job, it's the QA's job. No, this is an anti-pattern. This is what used to happen previously, but again, like I said, if we just concentrate on manual tests and automating some UI tests, we won't get quality code. Okay, so this is what it should be, the testing triangle. As you see, unit tests are at the bottom and cover most of the pod. So we should be writing the maximum amount of unit tests. As many tests that we write, unit tests should be the maximum. The quantity of unit tests, because unit tests actually test the small modules, the small units that we're working on. Then we have the integration tests, which again are really important, but should be in bigger number. Acceptance tests, or the functional tests, or the UI tests, whatever we want to call them, they again are very important, but because they're covering a bigger part of, you know, it's more of a macro testing that they do, I actually, you know, like to understand acceptance tests as black box testing. That's what I, you know, tell people when they need to think about how to differentiate between a unit test and acceptance test. So unit, you're testing your code. Acceptance test, you're testing the behavior, the functionality of the system. And then you definitely have the security and performance tests, which are very important, especially for, you know, applications which need to be secure, like banking applications and online shopping. So we definitely need to take care of performance tests. And at the end, we have exploratory tests. So even if we automate, you know, 95% of our application, we still need to explore our system. There are some things which can be found out just by exploring, and that's where exploratory tests come into the picture. When we're talking about unit tests, there are strategies like test-driven development, which can help you in, you know, not writing any code without tests. For acceptance tests, there is acceptance test-driven development. So going forward, we'll be talking about automating unit tests, acceptance tests, and exploratory tests. Unit tests via TDD, acceptance tests, ATDD, and the exploratory tests. I have kept some time for questions, but I think I'll pick them up at the end now. Okay, just one more poll. Before we go deep, how does your team test? Is it all manual? Some automated unit tests, rest manual. Some automated functional tests, such as acceptance testing, and the rest manual. We rock all automation. I'm looking at the numbers, and I'll close it in a few seconds. Okay, let's see where we are. So 45% say some automated functional tests, 34% say some automated unit tests, rest manual, and 21% people say all manual. I'm really surprised, like, how do they actually manage to test it manually, everything that's been built? I find it, you know, humanly impossible. When we're working in a Scrum model, when we're churning out code every 2 weeks, that at the end of the 2 weeks, you know, keeping time aside just for this. Okay, let's talk about test-driven development. What exactly is test-driven development? Test-driven development focuses more on the code quality. It's about building the product right. If you're following test-driven development, you won't write any code which doesn't have a test, you know, for it. I'll come to the red-green refactor cycle. So this is the basis of a test-driven development. You write a test that fails. Once you've written a test that fails, which actually looks like a very different thing for a developer, because you don't write anything that fails. You're supposed to write everything that's working. No, but the idea behind is write your expectation down via a test. So when you write your expectation down via a test, this is you need, it'll be failing because you've not written any code to make it pass. The next step is write enough code just to make it pass. So you do not write a lot of things. You just write some code to make it pass, which can be something like even hard coding things to start with. You can simply say, okay, like if I'm adding some numbers and I say, okay, if it is a single digit number, or if I don't get anything, if I get empty parentheses, I get empty number, return zero every time. So that's something like I've just hard coded it. Then we need to refactor it, which is improving the code quality. And then we might break the code again and it goes red. And then we write enough code to make that pass. The example that I gave you about, you know, adding numbers, the second part of that could be we can write another test about, okay, what will happen if I send two digits to it? I write a method which says, okay, pass two numbers, and I write enough code to make it pass. I do not think about all the errors at that time. I will definitely think about those errors, but that will be my next test case. So till I don't have a test case, I don't have a test that I've written, a JUnit test, to make that, you know, to think about what I'm going to develop in the next few minutes, I do not write a code for it. That's the idea behind red-green refactor cycle. So in this webinar that we're having, I'll be talking in real brief about these practices. We can cover these up, you know, in more detail if you want in the future. So what exactly is TDD or test-driven development? It is not exactly a testing technique, you know. It's more of a design strategy. It forces you to actually write simple code. You must have heard about the principle, keep it simple, stupid. So it's more about just write enough that's needed. Don't think beyond. Do not waste time, in fact, thinking beyond. In fact, the 10th principle of the Agile principles says that is simplicity. Simplicity and the art of maximizing the amount of work not done. We need to maximize the amount of work which is, you know, not needed and not write it. We just need to write what's enough to save time for us and keep things clean. So it's a way of development. But when we, you know, write tests in this way and we have emerging code coming out of it, we definitely build a testing suite on the side for it. That's where it helps us in regression testing also. So if a few months later you forget what you have developed and you're trying to fix something, you know, create something, and you break one of these tests, you'll know you have made a mistake. If you do not have these guardrails, these tests as guardrails for you, you'll never be able to actually know that you've broken something. So that's how these tests, if automated and executed every time you check in your code, will help you know what you've broken and what's working. So it's not just test-first development. It's test-first development is more of write all the tests together. No, it's not test-first also. It's more of write one test, write code for it. Write another test, write code for it, refactor to make it scalable and maintainable. It's a safety net, like I said, and it catches bugs early, even before they're born, because you're setting your expectations before you're writing the code. It's independent and repeatable process, and it's needed to have a good quality of code. So if quality of your matter, which is at times needed in some, you know, prototyping or things like that, yeah, you might not need to do TDD. TDD is needed when the quality of the code matters. If you want to throw away your code after a month or so, you don't want to focus and spend energy on TDD, because test-driven development comes with a cost. It needs some time. It's cost of quality that we're ready to pay if quality is important. The technologies that can be used are some XUnit frameworks. Like in Java, people generally use JUnit. NUnit is used in Microsoft things. There are mocking frameworks like EasyMock, PowerMock that are used, and there are many more technologies that are there. Depending upon, you know, the technology that you're working on, you can look for these. Now let's talk about acceptance test-driven development. Acceptance test-driven development is about building the right product. After I'm done explaining about acceptance test driven development, we'll definitely talk about the differences between the two and what, you know, does both bring to us. Should we do both or shouldn't we do both? We'll talk about this. So acceptance test driven development is about building the right product, the functional aspect of it. How is the system acceptable? It's all about that. It's a live documentation, so it's more about, you know, you do not have to write 100 pages of documents to store what's being, you know, built. No one's going to go and read those documents. Instead of that, build a test suite where your whatever you are documenting, whatever you are building is documented as tests. So if you in future write something which breaks one of those tests, you'll know then and there. You don't need to go and check in any of your documentations that exist. Okay, is this the current expectation of the system? No, my tests will let me know. They're more like executable requirements. So this is what the leaders in the industry have explained about acceptance test-driven development. It's about discussing. The product owner and the team discusses the story, what needs to be built. After they've discussed, they distill out from their discussion that, okay, what the team's gonna develop. When the team develops, they use a red-green refactor cycle again, the TDD cycle, to build the code that they're building. And then they demo it, and again, the discussion starts. To explain it more about how acceptance tests and test-driven go hand in hand, this is how it is. You write a failing acceptance test. That's red from an acceptance test level. Then you go to green. That means to make that acceptance test pass, you need to write a lot of code, which will be multiple cycles of this TDD red-green refactor. After you're done with your multiple cycles of red-green refactor at a unit level, you've built up a module, and that's where your acceptance test goes green. Once your acceptance test goes green, you need to refactor that too. And while refactoring, you might break it again. So you need to fix it again, green. And there are multiple acceptance tests that you'll write for a story. Maybe your story is thinly sliced, you just need one, maybe you need more. But definitely, for each acceptance test, you need multiple cycles of test-driven development. I've tried to explain it, you know, in our day-to-day work, how things work. We pick a story in the iteration, we understand the acceptance criteria from the product owner, and automate the first one as a failing test. Only the first one. Again, it's acceptance test-driven development. So we do not write any code before we write a test. So for the first one, we write a failing test. We start development in TDD to make the first acceptance test pass. So multiple cycles of TDD go in here. After we are done with that, we automate the next acceptance criteria. So my first acceptance criteria is green. It's working. Let's focus on the other one. Once we've automated the next acceptance criteria, we continue with TDD till all the criteria have been developed. So it's more of one acceptance criteria, multiple TDDs, then next acceptance criteria, multiple TDDs, and then we demo the story to the product owner. A good example here would be something like, I'm building a login page. So the first acceptance criteria will be, okay, when it's a valid username and a valid password, let me log in, take me to the welcome page. So I might have to write multiple, you know, I have to go for multiple test-driven development cycles to make that acceptance test pass. Once I'm done with that, now my next acceptance criteria says, if it's an invalid password, show me an error. So that's how you divide your acceptance criteria. There could be a third one which talks about forgot password, or that could be a totally different story too. That's how you actually try to divide your stories. So what is the difference between TDD and ATDD, or in fact, what to use when? Are we building the right product? And are we building the product right? These are two questions that we need to answer. When we are focusing on the right product, acceptance tests are important. We are talking about the functionality of the system, how the system needs to behave. So that's where acceptance tests really, really help you. They help you as they are the safety net that's there, so that even if you know you've not worked on, you know, as a team, you don't work on every part of the story or every aspect of the product that you're building. So even if your peer, even if your colleague has worked on something, the acceptance tests that exist in the system as safety net will help you know that you're not breaking something that was, you know, created by someone else. So following ATDD, to you know, when you're building the right product, when you want to build the right product, is what helps. And are we building the product right? This talks about the quality of the code. As I said, whenever the quality of the code is important, we need to follow unit tests. We need to write unit tests. And following TDD helps it further, because then we're not just unit testing, we are not writing any code without any unit tests. Generally, the products that we create are, you know, to be used for long-term things. So both the things are really important. If you have to scale your application, in that case, if you've not taken care of the code, if you've not focused on the quality of your code, if you've not written unit tests, if you've not followed TDD, you know even a small change that is needed in the code at times is a nightmare. It looks so difficult when the product owner feels it's a small change, and when we look at the spaghetti code that the product has, we feel, oh my God, who's going to work on it? Who's going to fix it? It might take 5 days. So if we continuously focus on the quality of the code, definitely it will really, really help you. Running an Agile project without automation is like walking the tightrope without a safety net, except the tightrope is on fire, someone is strumming it like a banjo, and you're wearing two left shoes. So this is what it is. I'm not sure if anyone of you experienced these problems when it's like small changes needed, but it gets so difficult. You don't know how the bugs came on production because you had fixed it 3 months back, and things like that. I've experienced it initially in my career, but I can tell you, start following these practices, which definitely comes with a cost because it takes a little more time initially. But if you look at the total cost about fixing defects on, you know, that have been discovered on production or later in the life cycle, this is really, really, you know, less time consuming and less costly. Coming to exploratory testing. So the question that comes to your mind at times is, even if you have 95% automated test, everything is test driven, even then do you need exploratory testing? Yes, you need it. But there are some, because there are some aspects which you might not have, you know, thought about or couldn't be automated. Something like, you know, a multi-threaded environment. You can test this, or you can try to write automated tests also to, you know, test it, but just give it another thought. Explore the system. Something like, you know, okay, what happens when two people click on the submit button together when they're filling a form for the same person? Does one overwrite the other? What happens? These kind of things you want to explore. So even if you're automating everything, still keep some time aside. Maybe add a task to your story, which will help you in exploratory testing. Session timeout scenarios. How will your system behave? I've seen some applications, about web applications, which have Ajax on it. And what happens is it stops responding. The user doesn't even know what's happening. It doesn't give an error message. It'll just not do anything. So those kind of things you might have not tested. Changes in browser preferences. What if someone has set the browser to something else? You don't know. So what exactly is exploratory testing? Someone who coined the term in 1984 defines exploratory testing as any testing process that involves simultaneous learning, test design, and test execution that run in parallel throughout the project. It's not ad hoc testing. It's not just manual testing. What it is, it's about learning the system continuously and then on the fly thinking about what needs to be tested in parallel throughout the project. So exploratory testing says, how do you actually define it's tested? So one, it is checked by your automation means and it's explored. Only then you can actually say, yes, I've tested the system. Explore continuously. So definitely you need to explore continuously. Everyone explores, so you don't have designated people who will do it. It's everyone's job. It's QA's job, it's dev's job, even the product owner, if he's interested, can explore and plan the exploration. Don't just keep it for an ad hoc thing. Plan it. What am I going to test? Something like, if you know you're working on a web application which will have session timeouts and things, add a task to your story. Plan it ahead that this is what I want to do it. It's not just at the end of the story you think of, you know, something and do it. Definitely you need to continuously explore it, but still plan some time at, you know, aside for it. So in short, I'll say testing in Agile works when it's a continuous team effort throughout the development. A lot of people feel that, you know, automating everything and it'll really be heavy for the team to work on. But I can tell you with my own experience, it's a continuous team effort. You need to be working as one team. It's not me versus you. It has to definitely be a team effort. That's the first thing to, you know, do before you actually go ahead with automation and everything. And the second thing is do it throughout the development. It can only be done throughout the development if you automate things. Now, let's look at some questions. How can we generate test case and test cases report in Agile framework? This is from Harish. So we can generate test case reports in Agile framework by, you know, continuously integrating your code on a CI tool like Jenkins. So if you have a tool like Jenkins, you can configure builds in it where you say, okay, whenever my team checks in, the job should execute and tell me how many test cases are passing and failing. It can be done, you know, for both unit tests and acceptance tests. You can have different jobs for both, or you can have the same one, you know, which executes both. How you can generate test cases is the way I said. Unit testing, you can use frameworks like JUnit. For acceptance testing, there are frameworks like Cucumber and Cucumber and JRuby. You can use Cucumber and Ruby. There are a lot of frameworks that exist in the market. If you want more details about it, you can drop me an email, or we can have another webinar which is focusing totally either on test-driven development, JUnits and everything, or we can focus totally on acceptance test-driven development. Okay. How we can do any story without accumulating bugs? We can do a story when, you know, the QA and dev, or, you know, if the team works together and sees that, okay, whenever you write a test and then you write a code, one thing is you're avoiding any kind of bugs that are coming in. But even after that, when you're exploring and you find a bug, close it then and there for the story. Don't put it in your backlog. Nitesh asks me, should the user story be closed once the bug is created? The first thing is try not to create bugs and fix them then and there. But if it's a minor bug, which is, you know, you don't want to spend a lot of energy there and your product owner agrees on it. So a user story can only be closed if your product owner feels that he can accept the story. If yes, then yeah, let your product owner know that that he can create a story and close it. Harish asks that security and performance tests are not functional tests. These will not be part of the story. Do we need to create separate story for non-functional testing? Harish, it all depends. You can have one story which does not focus on this, maybe because right now security and performance is not important, but it's just important for you to deliver, to create the product. And you can have another story which says, okay, for the same work for the current application, like for the login page, I want it to be responding back in 10 seconds. So you can definitely have a separate story, or if performance is really important and you want to, you know, and it's a small task that you feel can be taken care of and it's just that you need to test it, you can simply keep it part of the same thing. So even non-functional tests or non-functional requirements can be added as acceptance criteria and can be worked on either automated or in a manual way, but should definitely be added in the acceptance criteria. Mike asks, why do the functional tests fall in the testing triangle? I think they have to be before acceptance testing. So acceptance tests, functional tests, they all are, you know, testing the functionality. So they're different names. You can say that this is how I'm accepting the system. This is how I feel it's acceptable, or this is how it should function. So they're just different names, Mike. If the sprint cycle, Rohit asked this question, if the sprint cycle is of less time, is it necessary to write the test cases or execute the test cases? Definitely, Rohit. How do you know that, you know, if you've not tested the application or the code that you've written, that is, will it work or not? So sprint will always be of the same length. What you have to do is that the story that you're working on should be thinly sliced. It should be small enough so that you can cover everything. So test cases should always be written and keep the execution part in parallel, something like a build job or, you know, whenever you compile the code on your machine before checking in, it happens. So you won't even realize it's happening side by side. It'll be so seamless. Don't think about it's taking more time. Think that it's, you know, really important. How do I guarantee that I've written code that works? No one can do it without testing it. Sandeep asked me, as we talk, every team member will act as a tester. So we does the manual followed by a little automated. Okay, I think you want to know that if every team works as a tester, so should it be little automation and manual? No, it's not little automation. It should be everything is automated. Try to do it that way. And manual, just keep it for some exploratory aspects where you think, you know, it's not feasible to automate it or it's taking a lot of time for you to automate it. Otherwise, it's like you're just writing code only after you are writing a test. So everything gets automated. It's like that. Okay, Rajshri asks, is TDD applicable for all forms of development? So TDD is applicable anywhere where the quality of the code matters. I'm repeating it again. If you're working on some application which is a throwaway code, a stopgap arrangement, an R&D work, just a prototyping, the quality of the code might not matter to you at that time. So it's totally fine if you do not do TDD, but when the quality of your code matters to you, you should definitely do it. Harish asks, what is the difference between ad hoc testing and exploratory testing? Ad hoc testing is what at times, you know, is happening in the current development world. Okay, I just want to try to, you know, without any planning, without any, you know, thing in mind, what am I trying to test? Just try to execute it. Exploratory testing says keep things planned. Keep in mind what are you going to test. Nagaraja asks me, I have a question. If you expect a feature which is developed in 3 sprints, should we still automate? One thing is your feature might be developed in 3 sprints, but you need to have small stories which can be finished in each sprint. If you do not actually divide your stories, split your stories in small, it will be difficult for you to automate. But if something is being developed in 3 sprints or 3 months, it definitely needs to be automated, because what you have built in the first sprint, you don't have any guarantee that you've not broken it in the third or the fourth sprint. So it definitely is important. Pratik asks, how do we counter the situation where client has outsourced the testing to different vendor? In that case, you can discuss with the vendor about how you want it to be tested. Maybe ask them to write the acceptance tests for you so that they're building a, you know, safety net for the development that the developer is doing. Shantanu asked, which tool did you mention? Shantanu, is it regarding the ATDD? You can use Cucumber. Cucumber and Ruby, Cucumber and Java, Cucumber and JRuby, depending upon whatever you're comfortable with. Do we need tasks for testing that user story? So if you're doing, Rude asked me this question. So Rude, if you are doing a test-driven development or acceptance test-driven development, it's a way of development. You do not need an extra task for it, because any code that you'll write, you'll first write a test for it. But you should definitely have tasks for things like exploratory testing. Okay, we just have 5 more minutes. I'll try to, you know, cover up the questions that I have. What are the required metrics we should generate to capture quality of our testing? Ashutosh asked this question. Ashutosh, the best way of, you know, capturing the quality is have a CI tool like Jenkins, which is executing your tests whenever you check in, or if your automation, because your unit test should not take less than a minute or two to execute. So you can know that then and there about how many tests pass or you've broken something. Taking the acceptance test, when you're writing acceptance tests for a web application, so if you're writing it for, you know, normal Java code, a batch process, or, you know, some APIs that you've written, the acceptance test, at that time, you know, you can execute it faster. But when you're writing acceptance for UI, it generally takes a little longer because it's, you know, it tries to open the browsers and then do the testing. In that case, you need to capture, you know, you can still have your Jenkins jobs executed, but you might not want it every check-in, but you should still have it very frequently, maybe every hour. Okay. Sanjay asks, is there any guidelines for using TDD or ATDD? I mean, when do you use what? Does that method involve stakeholders, users, participations? So Sanjay, like I mentioned, TDD is to be used when code, the quality of your code is important. I think it's more of you know, a team's decision that how much is the quality of the code important. If you do not want bugs to leak and be found on production, definitely it is really important. And for ATDD, you need your product owner to, you know, actually help you with the acceptance criteria, which is anyways part of the user story, and you need to discuss it with your product owner and write those tests. Sayed asks, who is responsible to install and configure testing environment? The team. The team's responsible for that. Ravindra asks, how to manage both testing and design same sprint? Usually in embedded projects, testing is delayed by one sprint after development. Ravindra, you can do it by following test driven, because at that time you'll first be writing tests and then writing code. The idea is to reduce the size of your stories rather than, you know, skipping testing or design altogether. Okay, I think we are, I think I've tried to cover as many as I could. There's some still left, but I think we're short of time. So if there are any questions that are there later, you can write to me at my Gmail, or we can discuss it on the Discuss Agile Network. Thank you, everyone. Thanks for all your time. Thank you. Bye-bye.